kiss to the land. And all who've gone before us, and all who will believe, will sing the song of ages to the land. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries.
Good evening, Greater Second. This is another day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to another Wednesday night Bible study, virtual. We are so grateful and thankful. We believe that we are reaching a good audience, and we just thank God for you viewing tonight. We pray that all is well with the Greater Second Baptist Church family. And we want to continually lift up those who are sick and shut in. That always is running across the screen at various times. In the hospital, we know we have Brother Horace Crutchfield and Brother Dotson, and we just continually asking for prayer for them and the entire Greater Second Baptist Church family, those who've been in and now recuperating at home. We don't have all the names to call, but they'll be on the screen and the sick and shut-in list. Just when you pray, remember those who are recovering and continually keep a little miscellent Anastasia, I call her, love, as she recover. Continually pray for her. We're just looking forward for her to come back to church and shake the pastor's hand again. So we just thank God for the love family. And when any of our young people be suffering from something that young, we just wanted to make mention of that, and we're in prayer for her. Our youth ministry is constantly growing, and we can't afford to lose not one. Thank God for all of you. Thank God for this past Sunday. We had good attendance, and we just is always remembering that we didn't come here to stay. And whatever we're going to do for the Lord and his kingdom, we need to be doing it now. And we can't do nothing and accomplish nothing without his help that is for his kingdom and his glory. And that's going to require prayer. Prayer, prayer, prayer. Let's make sure that we don't forget how important it is to make prayer a priority. So would you bow with me as we make ready to open God's word this Wednesday night? Father in heaven, we humbly bow before thy throne of grace and mercy, thanking you for another day that you have made, knowing that without you, we cannot move, live, or have our being. So we're able to enjoy this day because of your grace and your mercy. Thank you for Greater Second. And, oh, Lord, as we move further into this year, we are in the mindset of celebrating 100 years of existence as the Greater Second Baptist Church family. And we give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise as we plan and look forward to a time of celebration, the fifth Sunday in September. We said thank you for this 100-year celebration as we plan to climax it. We just ask you to guide, lead, and direct those who will be working along to make this event one that you would get the glory from. And, oh, Lord, we just pray now for your blessings upon the Greater Second Baptist Church. Lord, as we begin to pray as a church and continually plan to build the right out manor on the 4.3 acres that you blessed us with, we just ask for Holy Spirit guidance. We pray for that there will be unity in our decision making. Help us as we go forward to do that which we believe you have charged us with because you gave us the land, and we thank you for it. Lead, guide, and direct us now. In Jesus' name we pray, and for his sake, amen. All right, as we begin this Wednesday night, this is the 24th of April, which is the birthday of Mother Opal Dean. She is now living in California with her nephew and niece, and they're taking good care of her. And today she's celebrating 99 years of living. And all of that time that I've known her, she has been one that stood high in my life and in the life of Greater Second Baptist Church. Her kindness and all, I met her 45 years ago. And we're just grateful for her. My wife and her talk at least once a month mostly. And we just try to keep in touch with her. And we praise the Lord. So, Miss Dean, if you're watching this, we just want to say happy birthday from your pastor and your Greater Second Baptist Church family. We love you. We thank God for you. And we just looking forward to God blessing you to stay here until he get ready to take you home to be with him. We thank God for you. Enjoy the rest of this day, and hopefully that your birthday has been one of joy. And we will always remember and keep you and your family, your nephew and niece. We thank God for them. And we just praise God for how they have taken care of you. God bless you and God keep you is our prayer. All right, church, we are continually studying Psalms 119. I know I've said this over and over and over, but I want to continually to emphasize that the reason we are bringing Psalms 119 to our Wednesday night virtual study is that we might find a new love or a renewed love or a continuing love for God's word, that we might wake up in the morning with a desire to spend time in God's word. Throughout the day, we will find time, hopefully, to open God's word. What we are trying to emphasize is a daily opening of the word of God. We have so many that is growing young and growing up, and we just want them to know also, as we have learned, that God's word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our pathway. We're trying to encourage this church to let's embrace God's word in our heart that we might not sin against him. I think it was Paul who told Timothy, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman, needed not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And the entire 119th number of Psalm is highlighting through the psalmist's life, his love for the word of God, his dependency upon the word of God, him knowing that God's word will take care of him, that as he goes through troubled times, as he goes through good and bad times, he has learned that he will rely on God's word, that God's word can be trusted. I'm a witness of how God's word transformed my life, how God's word was embraced by me at age 26 years old, and how I found myself drowning and my mind leaving me, and I am needing something to hold on to. And I grabbed hold to the word of God. And I am telling you from personal experience that God's word will keep you. God's word will lead you. God's word will guide you. God's word will be a foundation for you in life. God's word will help you in your prosperity. God's word will help you on your job. God's word will help you put a bridle around on your tongue. God's word will help you in your daily living. God's word will help you in dealing with your those who despitefully use you. God's word will definitely be an encouragement in time of suffering, sickness, affliction, whatever you're going through with. You can find comfort and strength in the word of God. Please, ma'am, please, sir, please, children, let's study, let's read, let's apply God's word in our daily living. Psalm 119, beginning at verse 89, the Hebrew word lamed, L-A-M-E-D, which has Hebrew meaning in a gorg or a prod, what the shepherd used to move the sheep along, that instrument that he used. It is said that in the Hebrew, that word, it means gorg or prod, as that instrument did in the shepherd's life with the sheep. You know, I don't know no Hebrew, so I'm just reading you what the commentary gives us. Let's start at verse 89. Verse 89 reads, "Forever, O Lord." Wait a minute now, make sure we get that. He's saying, "Forever, O Lord. Forever, O Lord." What? "Your word is settled in heaven." Other words, forever, O Lord, your word will not change. It's forever settled in heaven. Your word is not one that's changeable. It is always spiritually relevant. Y'all, that's good news. That's why we are wanting the church and the Christians and God's people to have a love for the word of God. And the psalmist here helps us to say, "Lord, forever, your word is settled in heaven. Your word will not change. You've already decided the dependency and the reliability and the immutableness, the unchangeableness of your word. In heaven, you have settled it when you said it, and it will always be spiritually relevant." Look, the Bible will never be outdated. It's old. It's an old book. It's one of the oldest, if not the oldest, but it will never be outdated. You will never have to redo it. So don't let nobody tell you, "Oh yeah, that's old fogey, and that's I know folks been saying this over and over." When I think about the word of God, and when God says something and it doesn't look like it makes sense to human beings, and sometimes not even to the one that's reading it or studying it, I am reminded of Noah's life. I am constantly amazed of what kind of predicament Noah was in when God told him to go and build an ark in the desert and get two of each kind of animals when that time come after he built it, and time to load up the ark, and because it's going to rain. And the Bible says Moses was dependable. He went out every day, and him and his family, and they worked on this ark. And the people were laughing at him. Generation after generation was laughing at him because it took so long to build it. And I think it was approximately 120 years it took to build the ark. And Noah, every year, another year that went by, and he got to be ridiculed and talked about. And remember this, church, it had never rained from the clouds, the heavens down. Earth was watered from like an underground sprinkling system. And this preacher is out proclaiming that God said it's going to rain. Now, the Bible wasn't written, but that's God's word. And God's word, the psalmist said, is settled in heaven. And you know the story. After he got it built, he loaded up two of each kind of animals. And then his family, and they went in the ark, and it rained, church, for 40 days and 40 nights. And the entire earth that was not in the ark alive was drowned, died. And God started over with one family, and that was Noah and his family. And from there, God repopulated the entire world that we know of as human beings now, and animals and all insects and everything. And all of it is because God said it. And even though man couldn't see it, even though it didn't make sense, but what Noah had is what we've got, and we've got the word of God. If I don't do much else with this, I want to highlight tonight again and remind us and encourage us that if God said it, it is true. You can bank on it. That sells it. You may not understand it, but God has said it, and God's word is settled in the heavens. Psalm 119, verse 89 says, verse 90 says, your faithfulness endures to all generations. Your faithfulness, God, all generations can trust you. What you say something, you're going to do it, and you being God, we can trust you, and it will endure, it will stand throughout all generations. It'll endure, it'll stand. You established the earth, and it abides. It's still here, it stands. And the reason it's standing is because you did it. You established the earth. The earth has not gone off its orbit since you have established it. You put it into being, and it's still here. That's amazing. I'm not a scientist or much in that science area. I was a business major. I loved English and math. But when you look and study the earth, all the other pretty much planets is so much bigger. Jupiter, I think, being the largest, and Pluto being the smallest. But Earth is in there. And then Earth is just the right distance from the sun. And it's not, if it was any closer, then we couldn't live here to burn up. If it was any farther, we'll freeze to death. So God divinely placed the earth where it can be inhabited by human beings. Look like if we could use human spiritual sanctified imagination, you would say God prepared the best place for mankind to live. And throughout all of existence, since he put it in place, it's still here. It's still here. Praise his holy name. The psalmist, it looked like he's just having a spiritual hallelujah time as he's looking at God being dependable, and God is still keeping things going. And it is still standing. Verse 90 concludes. Verse 91 says, they continue this day according to your ordinance for all your servants, for all are your servants. When I was reading this, it cross-referenced Jeremiah 33. And let me just read Jeremiah 33 and see, will it bless you like it blessed me? Jeremiah 33, beginning at verse 25. Listen there, let me read 25 and 26 together. And we are cross-referencing it because of what verse 91 said. They, which I think is talking about the people that belongs to God, they continue this day according to your ordinance, meaning they still in existence because of your word, what you have said, for all are your servants. They belong to you. They serve you. But Jeremiah 33, verse 25 and 26, that is here. Thus says the Lord, Jeremiah now speaking on behalf of the Lord. When you see thus says the Lord, the prophets were not guessing about what they were saying. They were saying, we're repeating what God has said. Thus said the Lord, watch this condition. If my covenant is not with day and night, and if I have not appointed the ordinance of heaven and earth, then I will cast away the descendants of Jacob and David, my servants, that I will not take any of his descendants to be ruler over the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, for I will cause their captivity to return and will have mercy on them. God said the reason things are going to go like they are is because my covenant, I have declared my covenant will be good day and night. If it were not, then the descendants of Jacob, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they would not stand. The reason Israel is still standing today, as small a country as it is, as mighty as it has become, is because these are God's people. God made a covenant with Abraham and Isaac, passed it on to Isaac and with Jacob. The covenant went on down all the way through, and a descendant of David will always be on the throne. And that was climaxed in the Lord Jesus Christ being a descendant of David, and he's going to be on the throne forever. And all of that is because of the covenant that God has made. That's what I believe Psalms 119:91 is alluding to. And he said, for all are your servants. The they and the all go together. Number 92, unless your law had been my delight, unless your law had been my delight, unless I had not found delight in your word, unless your word had been my what made me glad, I would then have perished in my affliction. If I had not picked up your word and found gladness in your word made my soul glad. That's what delight. I delight myself in the law of the Lord. I delight myself. I find myself, my soul, the core being of me, being glad according to your word. And unless in your word had not been my delight, if I had not viewed your word like I did, if I had not brought your word into my heart and allowed your word to make me glad, then I would have perished in my affliction. I wouldn't have made it. That's the Blackfish interpretation of that verse, I believe. He said, ain't no way in the world I could have made it. with what I went through, my affliction, the way I've been going through. I couldn't have made it if I had not found delight in the Word of God. Oh, I can say praise the Lord. I can say thank you, Jesus. I can say hallelujah. I understand now what he's talking about, because I experienced much of that in my affliction. If I could not have embraced the Word of God, if I wouldn't have had a Bible, if I wouldn't have been able to bring God's Word into my life during my affliction, ain't no way in the world, church, I could have made it. So I find delight in the Word of God. God's Word just makes my soul glad. Number 93 says, I will never forget your precepts. And I'm just using precepts and all of that. I'm translating it into just saying God's Word. I ain't no way in the world I can make it without God's Word. And the psalmist said, 93, I will never forget your Word. We are in the Baptist church. There were many times when churches taught memory verses. You had to memorize verses. I remember growing up, before we eat, all the children had to memorize a particular verse. And when we sat down together at this table where the family sat and ate growing up, everybody would have to say a verse. And mama would most of the time offer the blessing of the food. And each child, before they eat, would say a verse. And I will remember that verse as long as I live. That verse came out of the Beatitudes that mama gave her children. And it was, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Oh, that verse still blesses me. Blessed are the pure in heart. I mean, if your heart is right, God will bless you. Blessed are the pure in heart. Listen at this part. For they shall see God. Nothing but the pure in heart. No one but the pure in heart. Your heart got to be changed, church. We can go to church all our life. We can read our Bible. But I'm telling you, the heart got to be changed. And the Psalms are saying God's Word will do that. And he will never forget the Word of God. For by them, your precepts, your words, your commands, for by them you have given me life. I wasn't taken out. I didn't lose it. Your Word gave me life. It brought hope and endurance. And it's the reason that I was able to live. Verse 94, I am yours. Save me. I'm yours. And you look at whatever affliction he was going through with. Saved here is not meaning salvation, as we said, born again. Saved here means deliverance. He's telling God, whatever I'm in right now, I am yours. I belong to you. Deliver me from whatever I'm going through, for I have sought your precepts. I have went after your word. The wicked, verse 95, the wicked wait for me to destroy me. Those folks that belong to Satan, those demonic people, the wicked, those unsaved folks, he's saying now, they wait for me. They wait to destroy me. They are out to get me. Satan comes. Remember this. Have a threefold purpose. Satan comes. But to steal, kill, and destroy. He said, that's the reason, John 10. That's the reason Satan comes. And then Jesus said, but I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Don't forget, the devil is not our friend. He will dress up temptation. He will always talk about how it will gratify the flesh, but don't fall for the tricks and the cunningness of the devil. Don't allow wicked folks to shape your thinking, your mind. He said, for I will. He said, the wicked wait for me to destroy me, but here's the way I'm. I can't control the way they action. I can't control their action, but I can control what I'm going to do. I will consider your testimony. Now, I don't mean I'm going to make my mind up whether I'm going to listen to them or not. He said, I consider. I bring them into my consciousness and think about them and apply them to my life. Your testimony, what you have said, is what I'm going to rely on. And the closing verse said, I have seen the consumption of all perfection. I have seen the consumption. I have seen, mean past tense, I have seen the consumption here, or the destruction of all perfection. Now, perfection, the fundamental idea here is completeness, he's saying. Now, we know God is absolute perfection. He's not talking about God here being consumed. He's talking about the perfections of mankind. I've seen the consumption. I've seen consumption mean destruction. I've seen the destruction of all of man's perfectionists. But look here. But your commandments is exceedingly broad. There is no consumption of your commandments, for they are much too broad. I hope tonight that again we have brought you some encouragement from the Word of God, again, knowing that His Word is forever settled in heaven. Heaven is not trying to come up with something else. The Word of God is forever settled in heaven. Let's bow for closing prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you now for again a time to study your Word. Lord, we're so grateful for you allowing us to serve this, your people, for 14 years of pastoring. We are grateful and thankful for you placing and planting us here. Help us always to continue to bloom where we have been planted. Continually let your kindness, your mercy, and your grace fall upon these, thy people, here at the Greater Second Baptist Church. And forever we will remember the struggle that Israel is in and is going through, and so many other countries is being attacked. We just praying now for the peace of Israel and asking that you will allow the United States of America to always be a friend to Israel. Bless our country, bless our leadership, bless our president as he plan and campaign for 4 more years. Oh God, we're praying blessings upon his life as he seek another 4 years of serving this country. Guide, lead, and direct the United States of America, we pray. In Jesus' name and for his sake, amen. God bless you this day and always is our prayer. Hope to see you Sunday morning as we come to celebrate the pastor's and wife 14th anniversary. Dr. Arthur Blood will be preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ here Sunday morning. God bless you this day and always is our prayer. See you Sunday morning, we pray.